Welcome to Lab 3, fine-tuning. In the last one, we learned how to create your own GenAI app, how to upload it to H2 AI Cloud. Before that, we learned how to do RAG. Now we're learning how to create your own LLM, how to fine-tune your own language models first and then large language models. So we'll jump into the code, as I promised, minimal theory, maximum code. Let's dive into the notebook and move to the correct tab. So we're on Lab 3 now. Please note that your environment might look slightly different, or this might be slightly different of an interface for you. Don't worry about that at all. So what we're going to do now is first we'll learn how to do it using Hugging Face's open source library. So we'll fine tune a simple model, and then we'll learn how to fine tune like a grandmaster using LLM Studio. So fine-tuning refers to the task of taking a pre-trained model and fine-tuning it to a downstream task. You can read through all of this theory. But simply put, we're taking a BERT-based model and then fine-tuning it to a task. So let's import all our relevant stuff and import the glue and WNLI datasets. So you can read more about these data sets here, and you have a nice link that details about all of this. For all purposes, it's a reading comprehension task, simply put. But you can read more details up here in the link. So let's print this out to see if it's been imported correctly. There are about 600 examples in train, 71 in validation, and 140 in test. So that looks about right. From here, we'll import auto tokenizer to auto magically tokenize all of our text, and we'll tokenize the sequence. This will be fun and see how that performs here. So you can see it's been tokenized properly. I can also take a look at the integers assigned to all of the inputs. So I can simply pass in the sequence to the tokenizer, and it will give me the input IDs and also the token type IDs along with the attention masks. From here, we'll tokenize our data set, and we'll call data collator by passing the tokenizer function to it. After that, we'll import the model using auto model for sequence classification, and we'll call it from pre-trained because we'll use a pre-trained model to start with. From there, we'll set the number of labels to 2, and we'll pass in the checkpoint which we had defined above to be BERT-based uncased model. So this is the name of the model from Hugging Face Hub. So I'm going to run this. And it's saying, hey, you should probably train this on a downstream task. That's exactly what we're going to do. So for that, we'll create a trainer object to begin fine-tuning, and we'll pass on the train data set, the eval data set, and the data collator function along with the tokenizer. Once we've done that, we can simply call the train function on the trainer to start training the model. This will take, on my system, 2 minutes. It might take slightly longer or lesser depending on how powerful your system is. And after that, we would have trained BERT-based model onto these 2 example data sets we had taken a look at earlier. All right, so I am Sayam from the future, 2 minutes in the future, after which this model finished training. You can see it automatically spits out a few details, how many steps it ran for, the loss function, and the number of epochs. For all purposes, this is just to give you a taste of how you'd normally fine-tune, so I'm not very much concerned about these metrics. Although if you like, you can very much so optimize these if you'd want. From here, what we'd like to do is generate predictions on the validation dataset. So for that, we'll call trainer.predict. Remember, we had trained using trainer.train. Now we'll call trainer.predict onto the validation dataset. And we can then print out the predictions, their shape, and the shape of the labels. So you can see there were about 71 inputs, and there should be 71 predictions, and that is indeed the case. We can print out the logits directly. So to do that, let's print the predictions and let's take a look at the first 10 logit values directly. Now to turn these into predictions, you'll have to call the argmax function. We'll call np.argmax over predictions.prediction on axis minus one. I'm sure many of you would have run through this similar pipeline earlier or in different flavors, so I'm not going to go into a lot of details. This was just to give you a taste of how you use Hugging Face API, its trainer pipeline, to fine-tune a simple language model or a small language model, which in this case was BERT-based. We only ran it for 3 epochs, and then we looked at how to generate predictions. So from here, we'll learn how to fine-tune like a Kaggle Grandmaster and how to fine-tune a large language model. So please look at this notebook or the notes inside this course to learn how to access LLM Studio properly. But since I already have it up and running, I can directly jump into it. So once you've followed those instructions, you will arrive at this page, which is the home screen of H2O LLM Studio. And you can see your finished experiments and running experiments right here. We start at datasets, and instead of printing everything, I can click on the dataset I want to view. And I can see the question and the corresponding answers of it. I can get a visualization along with the summary, which tells me there are about 8,000 examples in this dataset. So I encourage you to play through these different menus as a homework. What I'm going to do now is click on Create Experiment, and this sets up an experiment for me. So H2O LLM Studio has a lot of best practices from our Grandmaster team to fine-tune large language models. So a lot of best practices are baked into this no-code or low-code tool. You can also use this through an API, although I personally prefer using the UI quite a bit. It's very intuitive and easy to use. So for this example, to keep it continuous, we'll do language modeling. But you can see that there are also a lot of other training options supported, a lot of other problem types supported in LLM Studio. It always gives interesting experiment names, which I leave it at that. But my suggestion would be to please name these to something more useful if you're like actually working on a serious problem. It's always a good idea. If you're following the training, just enjoy the name it comes up with. After that, we can select the backbone we want to work with. Let's do Llama 2 7 billion. If you've already fine-tuned a model that you want to continue working on, you can also select that here if you'd like. From here, you see the dataset settings where you can select the data frame, its prompt column, its answer column, special tokens, all these details. After which you can then select the tokenizer settings. So you might see that this is very similar to notebook. It's by design, because in the notebook, we looked at how you can tokenize a simple sentence. Here we're looking at how to set the tokenizer settings for a very large data set for a large language model. So I can set the prompt length, the maximum length of the answer and the prompt, the maximum length overall. I can also select the padding quantile and enable fast tokenization. After that, I can select if I want to use an integer 4, data type, backbone, int 8, or float 16. My suggestion is to always stick in this area, never go above float 16. And you can also enable gradient checkpointing if you're compute constrained. From here, you can select the loss function, the optimizer, and the learning rates, and enable or disable differential learning rates. Also enable flash attention too if you'd like. After that, you can set the number of batch size and epochs that you want to run this for. And then you can enable LoRa fine tuning and select its corresponding hyperparameters. After that, you see some augmentation settings, which I'll leave at default for this example. And also the prediction settings. These are very straightforward across all NLP problem types, so I'm glancing over them. Since I'm happy with this, I'll click Run Experiment, and this will kick off the training. Earlier, I had run the exact same experiment. So I wanted to show what a completed experiment looks like. Here you can see I get a single screen to monitor how the training had progressed. And you can also monitor this while the experiment happens. So you can get a summary of the experiment right here. I can see its nice name, the backbone I had used, and the data type I had used. From here, I can also see how I can then programmatically also use this with the Hugging Face transformers if I'd want. If I want, I can also take a look at the validation insights, right? Which show me the metric, the answers, the blue score, the predicted text, and the target text. And if your GPU is free and if you're not training another model, you can also chat with the trained model right here in the interface. So you can see the experiment from earlier has started, and in real time, LLM Studio allows me to monitor all of the relevant details that you could care about while the model is training. This is a sample. This is a training example, right? This is supposed to run in just a few hours. But LLMs in the wild take hours and days and weeks sometimes to fine-tune also. Although usually days to fine-tune. So it's quite a good idea to be able to monitor all of this centrally. I think it's really great you can do that. You can also compare experiments right here if you'd like. Once the model has finished training, you can also push it directly to Hugging Face. And to enable that, you might have to upload your passwords here, your access keys inside the settings. So you can put those in, and then LLM Studio can directly push the document to Hugging Face Hub as well. So this was the third lab, how to fine tune a small language model using Hugging Face, and then how to fine tune a LLM, like a grandmaster, using H2O LLM Studio. LLM Studio is fully open source. You can install it locally to run it yourself as well. But this was to give you a taste of how fine tuning traditional models compares against how fine tuning large language models compares, and the best practices of both the worlds. In the next module, we'll learn how to prepare datasets properly before sending them to fine tuning. This is something we glanced over, and many people glance over, because it's always important to prepare the data correctly and in a nice format. So let's take a look at that. For your homework from this one, please train more experiments using LLM Studio. Go through all of the menus, try to change a lot of settings if you'd like.